This week's episode of So Wrong It's Right was brought to you by Foxy Bingo. Put some fox in your day with new, quick and interactive bingo experiences all at the tip of your finger. They have a huge range of free, classic and exclusive games you can play with your mates to keep the party going. Want to connect with other players? Foxy Bingo has a community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18 plus, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.
And then I remember you walked out and I felt like our relationship changed.
He's much more than a matchmaker. He's this and this and this. I'm still tripping out that I'm seated across from the founder of the It.
Give me three red flags.
Once a narcissist, always a narcissist. But then, you know, you say, all right, take your shoes off and let me see your toenail.
It is my pleasure and honor to welcome you, Paul Brunson, to So Wrong It's Right.
Can I say, it is my honor to be here, really.
Let's give my listeners some context, because I was about to dive into the fact that you're a wealth of knowledge and there's so much I want to get into, and I really want my listeners to be able to take away some actionable nuggets of advice today. But it's not the first time I've seeked your advice. In 2018, we were together on Celebs Go Dating. You were my mentor.
Yes.
And I was a contestant.
Yes.
If you didn't watch that series, guys, you can just pop yourself over to YouTube and type in Olivia Attwood Celebs Go Dating. It'll give you a little idea of the headspace I was in. Erratic would probably be a great word.
Capital E, yes. Do you remember the incident?
There were so many. Which one?
So I consider this our incident.
Okay.
You remember our incident? You remember this? Because we had several, but there was one where I felt like I called you out.
Oh, shit. Yes. Okay.
All right. So can I unpack?
Yeah, please.
Okay. So one is I was by myself hosting at that time.
Yes, you were.
So there was stress.
Just a lot.
Okay. It was my first time in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know any of the contributors. So I was like, Love Island? I've never seen Love Island. Like, I've never seen a TOWIE. What is TOWIE? Like, never seen any of these things. And I remember watching and observing all of the contributors off camera and then on camera.
Yes.
And here you come into the agency. You sit in front of me, right? And we're talking. And I said something along the lines of, I don't believe you. I think you're fake.
I remember this.
Do you remember this? Yes. Do you remember this?
Something that no one's ever said this to me before, so it floored me.
Yes.
Floored me. I was like, I'm many things, but I'm not fake.
You see the neck?
Yes.
You did the neck. You did the neck. You did the hands. And you look like you wanted to just like shoot fire out of your eyes to me. Like, what are you doing? Why are you doing this to me?
Yeah.
Well, this is supposed to be fun and happy.
Yeah.
What? And then I remember you walked out and I felt like our relationship changed at that point. Right. And I would always say the reason why I said that is because to this day, you're one of the most intelligent people I've met. I've told you this. You know, I've told you this.
Yeah.
I've written this. And then some people will say, really? Olivia Attwood? She's one of the most intelligent people. I was like, yeah, she is. But you don't see it. And what I was trying to say in that moment is I didn't see it.
Mm.
I saw you being a reduced version of yourself. That's why I was saying you were fake. You were playing smaller and you should have been playing bigger. That's what I was trying to say.
I mean, it's a huge compliment when you unpack it after you get past fake. But I mean, from you, I do remember you saying that to me. And I remember you telling me that you thought I was smart and intelligent, especially at that time in my life where, like you say, I was especially leaning into playing the fool.
Mm-hmm.
Which is something that I think a lot of people, especially women, default to. And it's a comfortable place. I almost kind of, I didn't believe it myself. I thought, oh, he says it to everyone to gas them up and get them in the right headspace.
No.
No.
No. And to the point of a lot of women play to that is, you know, we still live in a patriarchy. So there, I could understand competitively why it's important in terms of survivability. I can understand why it's important, but why it's so important for you and for the yous of you, of the world not to, is because so many little girls look up to you.
Mm.
And they see what you're doing. And what I always say is that we will be what we see.
Yeah.
Right? And what we see a lot of, we will really be. And so many people love and adore you. I didn't want them to play small. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I think you've now, evolved to a place where you're playing big. I mean, this is big.
This is big. This is why having you here is so monumental, because the pod and the documentaries, it's all, I think, part of that era of me, like you say, playing big and using my brain and giving my opinions, and not just opinions for the sake of controversy, like things I actually think, I believe. I've changed the way I live my life in the last 5 years.
Yes.
And I want to share that, you say, with younger girls and guys that follow me.
Yes. You know, I mean, you've grown up.
Yeah.
You've grown up.
Just a bit.
Yeah.
There's one more memory before we move on to you, because this isn't about me, although, which is, what? Do you remember, you probably do remember, when we was on Celebs Go Dating together, I was obviously non-exclusive, but I was dating my husband Bradley, basically kind of behind the scenes. But I was like, obviously snogging these guys, but I wasn't taking it seriously, you know.
Yes.
And I said, you said to me one day, oh, you're kind of holding back. And I was like, yeah, well, this is ex-boyfriend and I don't know, like, think I should give another go with it. And you were like, and I listed off the reasons why it hadn't worked. And then you, probably rightfully so, said, I think you should just leave it alone. Mm-hmm. We're married now.
Yes. Yes.
But it's not been smooth.
No.
It's not been like, you know, easy, but... Yeah.
But I mean, well, one is congratulations.
Thank you.
Right, this is good. Keep in mind, you were telling me these things and you were on a dating show. Come on, you were on a dating show and you're like, yeah, I got this guy over here to the side. And I was like, wow, this is wild. But congratulations.
I think in that situation, you're not exactly going to turn around to me and go, yeah, do you know what, pursue it. I feel like it sounds really healthy and like you're going to be happy forever. Right, let's move on to you, Paul, because there's so much of you. Matchmaker, right. World-renowned entrepreneur, author, TV host, to name a few. Which of all of these titles, which of these jobs really feed your soul?
I mean, I wouldn't put it in the job category, but husband, father, brother, uncle, son.
That's what makes you happy.
Cousin. Oh, yeah. That's me. All day long. Like, that is me.
That's so interesting. Mm-hmm. You talk a lot about loving yourself. And basically, you know, if you don't love yourself, no one else is really going to truly love you, or they're not going to know how to treat you.
Yes.
And I know that a lot of my listeners are probably listening to this right now going, yeah, but that's so easy said than done. It's such a buzz phrase, isn't it? Love yourself. For me, someone who has come from actively not liking myself, mm-hmm. I probably didn't like myself very much in that time when we first met,
yeah.
and been on that journey, but it happened kind of subconsciously. What are some words of wisdom you could give to our listeners?
Yeah, this is a brilliant question, because we often hear, yeah, just love yourself. You're like, well, how do I do that?
Yeah.
It's crazy. So here's the nerdy way, but this honestly, this has changed my life. And I wrote this in my book, is that there is something called the six dimensions of psychological well-being.
Wow.
Right? It's by Dr. Carol Riff, who is brilliant. I'm obsessed with her. I will leave my wife for Dr. Carol Riff. Like, I'm obsessed with Dr. Carol Riff. And what she did is, in the 1980s, mm-hmm. she studied all of the greats when you think about theories around well-being and self-love. Maslow, Eric Erickson, Carl Jung, Aristotle. Like, she's studying all of them. And she looked at all their theories and figured out, how do they overlap? Mm-hmm. And she figured out they overlap in these six dimensions. So her theory is that if you can focus on each one of the six and just become a step better, your well-being goes up. And overall, if you have a higher well-being, your life gets better. So what are the six? One of them is personal development.
Okay.
And that is taking on new tasks, new initiatives, and more importantly, learning new skills. So if you're learning something new, you have better well-being.
Yeah.
Another one is your relationship with friends.
Mm-hmm.
Another one is autonomy. So autonomy isn't just controlling your time.
Mm.
Autonomy means that there are social pressures in life, but you choose to show up as you. You're not seeking the validation of the public.
So it's being authentically yourself.
Pure yourself. But there's others. There's one called environmental mastery, which is so interesting. So environmental mastery means that you feel like where you live,
mm-hmm.
where you work is conducive to a good life. And you could think about it, this is how simple it is. When you wake up in your bedroom, like, do you like your bedroom?
Yeah.
You know, or do you have clothes all over the place? Do you feel like it's just not, you don't feel happy in it?
Yeah.
Or can you organize it and then maybe uplift the happiness? So there's six dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
If you can work towards just a step better in each one of the six, you have higher well-being, you have higher self-esteem, you have higher self-love.
That's really powerful. And I think that like you say, there's steps there that everyone can take.
Yes.
And it's little things for me that I, you know, looking after yourself, when you're actually caring for yourself, you're eating good food, you're going to the gym, the way you feel about yourself automatically changes. It's hard to kind of hate something that you're caring for.
Yes. And the beauty is that then that acts as a defense for toxic people entering your life.
Yes.
Because you love what you're caring for so much, you don't want it to be disrupted.
No.
So that's why self-esteem, high well-being is the best defense against toxic boyfriends, girlfriends, et cetera, because you want to raise up your well-being.
That's super interesting. And I look back on relationships I was in or things that I dealt with, and I think, I would never stand for that now.
Yeah, no,
never.
Never.
I didn't really question it at the time. I just went, oh, okay, like, that's part of the deal.
Yeah.
You like beautifully segued us there onto something I wanted to jump onto, which is toxicity. Mm. And in your book, there is a chapter about this and how to spot a toxic partner. And I think, again, another buzzword on TikTok, Instagram, narcissism, everyone's a narcissist. Everyone's toxic. Paul, give me three red flags for someone, either in a toxic dating relationship or you like, these three are non-negotiables, get the fuck out.
Okay, yeah, and I'm with you. Everybody is all these things. Everybody's gaslighting.
We want to label everything, don't we? We're obsessed with labels in 2024.
We are obsessed. We love them in it because it simplifies things that we feel are very complicated.
Yes.
So I understand why we do it, but it's very dangerous. And the reason why it's so dangerous is because if you are a victim of a true narcissist, that changes your life.
Yeah.
And so we are discrediting the real victims of narcissism when we say everyone's a narcissist.
Yeah. You know?
So we have to call a thing what it actually is. So in terms of toxicity or what is called the dark tetrad, all right, this is the psychological terminology for this. Mm-hmm. And what it means is that there are people who are narcissists.
Yes.
You have people who are psychopaths. So actually, let's even break it down. A narcissist is someone who is 1,000% about using you for their own good.
Okay.
So it's like picking up a cup of coffee. Mm-hmm. They'll drink the coffee. You are the coffee. As soon as they're done with the coffee, they have no need for the cup. They have no need for you. Once a narcissist, always a narcissist. One of my best friends, Dr. Angela Smith, is one of the top narcissism experts in the world. And I'm often talking to her about this. And it's scary because if you are in a relationship with a narcissist, it means they will always be a narcissist. You can help and they can manage some of their behavior, but they'll always have that philosophy of using. So that's a narcissist.
Are they consciously doing this?
They are consciously and subconsciously doing it. So you have narcissism. That's one of the dark tetrads. You have a psychopath, right?
Okay.
A psychopath, in essence, doesn't feel pain in your pain. So they're not empathetic at all.
So I can see someone breaking down, sobbing. They've just lost their grandmother and they feel nothing.
They feel nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing at all. And then there's a sadist. So if you are breaking down crying, you've just lost your grandmother, you know what a sadist is doing?
Enjoying it.
They're enjoying it, absolutely. Because a sadist enjoys your pain. And then there's one that's not often talked about, and that is called a Machiavellian. And this is from Nicola Machiavelli, who wrote the book, The Prince, which is one of my favorite books. And it's about manipulation.
Yeah.
So this is someone who just wants to manipulate you for gameplay. So that is all right, I see Liv over there. I know she's married, whatever. I'm still going to get her number. And I'm going to do it just to do it. Or I'm going to get her to go over there and pour a drink for whatever. Like, I'm going to gameplay just for the fun of gameplay.
Oh, wow.
So you have Machiavellians, you have sadists, you have psychopaths, and you have narcissists. This forms what's considered the dark tetrad.
Okay.
These are the relationships. These are the people that if you enter, your relationship will always be toxic.
Mm.
Always. The commonality, because you're asking about red flags.
Yeah.
The commonality is no empathy.
Okay.
And this is why we have a lot of research to show that people in the dark tetrad, especially narcissists and psychopaths, they do the best at dating.
Yes, because they're always dating.
They're always,
that's why all these stories are about that we hear so much about them.
Yeah, they're always dating.
What could you say to someone who, if they're such good actors, how could you spot a lack of empathy?
Well, there's several things. One is that someone who is obsessed with themselves, that is someone who lacks empathy, and that's typically someone who is going to be fit within that dark tetrad. So it is the person actually who's in the gym 24/7.
David Lloyd now.
Yeah. It's like people are like, oh my God. But think about that. I'm talking about 24/7.
Like obsessive.
Obsessive. And what I find interesting with the mental health conversation, and this will get me into trouble, but I'm going to call a thing, is a lot of us are saying, oh, you know, I go to the gym for my mental health. Do you really? Or do you go to the gym so that you will have larger muscles so that you can then flex those in front of whoever? Like, is it for your mental health? Or is it because you want to get external validation?
Yes.
Right? Because if it's for your mental health, that's okay.
Yeah.
But if it's for you just want to wear tight shirts to show off your biceps, that's external validation. That's not your mental health.
Okay.
You will go through extreme highs and extreme lows. You are going to get the podcast, get the show, but you're also going to maybe lose a loved one, lose a job.
Yeah.
And you want to see how does your partner show up when that happens. That's the best way to test empathy.
Because you can't test that in a matter of months because not enough life is happening.
Not enough life has happened.
It's interesting you just mentioned that with the straight away as you said that about podcasts. And it's still, because I think I dated quite a lot of, well, I don't know if I'm going to call them narcissists, but I would say they showed narcissistic traits. Mm. My wins were a lot smaller. You know, they're bigger now. I'm doing little air quotes if you're listening to this in the car. But it's still kind of crazy to me how much Brad celebrates for me, because I dated people who anything I got that was good news or a job or a positive, they'd find a way to be like, really? Oh, I'm happy. If you're happy, I'm happy. But, oh, I thought you, okay, that's interesting. Or, you know, if I bought something and they'd be like, oh, if you like it, like, you know, and it was still now and, it, you know, things are happening for me and Brad's genuinely so happy
for me.
And I'm kind of took back by it because after years of not having that, I'm like, shit, you're really not trying to put a negative on this or trying to talk me out of doing it. You're just happy for me.
He's just happy. And that also shows that Brad has higher self-esteem.
Yes.
Right, because he's in it for you, not for how this thing impacts you.
And it's a lot. Like, as you know, they always talk about guys, but it's like, you know, a lot of guys have issues. Like, imagine having me as your wife in the shows and the podcast. And it's like, it would be like, okay, just shut the fuck up already. I'm like, I can't. It's literally my job. So
the fact that he's cheering you on is a strong sign of how great the relationship is and then can be.
Oh, yeah. Paul, there's so many interesting takeaways from this chat about narcissism and toxicity. If one of the listeners who's listening to the pod today is ticking off one or two of these red flags and they think, I need to get out of this situation, whether it be casual dating, long-term marriage, and they're going, but I don't even know how. And actually, how do you even break away from someone that's a manipulator?
Yeah, it is. It's very challenging. Mm. And I think a lot of people who are not in that scenario just say, oh, just leave.
Yeah.
It's not as simple as that. You can have children together. A lot of these manipulators, what they do is they isolate you financially.
Yeah.
So you are reliant on them financially. So you can't just walk out. I think there's a couple things that you should do. Number one is you want to assess, do you feel under physical or verbal threat? This is very important because if you feel under physical threat, that makes it more immediate. If you feel under verbal threat, it makes it more immediate because verbal typically precipitates physical. Yeah. So that's the first question that you want to ask yourself, right? Secondly, is that you want to begin to figure out who is your support system that can assist you in this. Do you have family, friends, et cetera, that you can go to? Or are you so isolated that you feel as if that's not possible? And then the third is then you want to, based on those two, you want to begin to create your plan to step away. For many of us, we can just step away.
Yes.
Right? And that's a privilege to be able just to say, you know what? I'm not going back there tonight. Mm. But for many of us, we can't. We've been moved to another country. We have two or three children. We have no access to our bank accounts, right? Because because our partner has access to it. And it's not as simple as just walking away. So you have to create a plan. Now, there are many resources online. But I would say that the key, because it depends on the scenario, because there could be violence, et cetera, is that you want to reach out to a professional. This is very, very important, because what most people do, and I'm not just saying most just to say it, this is most people just stay. Mm. Whenever they feel anchored by a child or by finance, they typically just stay because they think staying is beneficial for the child.
Yes.
But I'm here to tell you, staying is the worst thing you could do for your child, because your child knows the pain and stress that you're under. And I bet you your child may think it's their fault.
Oh, wow.
Your child will learn how to emotionally suppress themselves because they see you emotionally suppress yourself. If your child is watching you being beaten, your child will think that is what love is, and they will attempt to emulate that. I had a client, and I talk about this in the book, whose grandfather was physically violent towards his partner. The father was physically violent towards his partner. So this person began to think, this is how I show my love. I show my love by raising my hands. And so we have to understand that our kids will be what they see.
Yeah.
And so that's why when you're walking away from a situation like that, it becomes very nuanced. So you want to assess your threat, level of threat. You want to identify your support system being two. And then three is you want to create a plan for you to remove yourself.
That's really helpful, breaking it down. Like you say, I think I don't have children, so I'm speaking of things that I read and I see of people that do, but they're aware of much more than we realise, aren't they? And like you say, it's crazy to think psychologically of watching something terrible with your parents, an abusive pattern. You think then in their life, they'd want to make sure their life looks nothing like that. But we just end up mirroring sometimes the example that was shown to us without even realising it.
I think parenting is underrated.
Yeah.
You know, the impact that you have as a parent, you are literally molding a young mind. Mm. And they will emulate what they see. They'll emulate what you think they don't see. You know, even like with my parents, for example, my parents, they loved my brother and I. And they thought, we're not going to argue in front of them. We're going to go out and argue in a different room.
Okay.
They thought that was love. But you know what? That means that my brother and I don't understand that, you know, in a loving relationship, you do argue.
Yeah.
And in a loving relationship, here's how you resolve your argument. We didn't learn those skills. And so this is the reason why parenting parenting is one of the most important jobs in the world. In the world.
You're literally forming a human being to go out into the world, and the effects that's going to, the chain of effects that's going to come from that one person, the people they date, the children they raise, it's people really minimize it.
Absolutely.
And that's, I'm, you know, this is a whole other topic, but I'm, you know, grilled constantly about kids. When do you have a baby? And I just think it's very minimized. And I think, I'm not just having a baby, am I? I'm having a child, a human.
Yes.
Like, I need to make sure that I am in the right point in my life. I want to be all in, but this is my baby right now, and the show's my baby, so I can't have more than one. Not right now.
Yeah.
There's a way to have both at some point, but it's not now.
See, and I think that's the right mindset.
Yeah.
Because I think we too flippantly go into, into parenting. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, oh yeah, we're just gonna have a baby. Let's go half on it. It's like, really?
And another thing that you touched on there, which I always talk about this on social media, and I know people probably look at me on social and think, oh, you've got a job you love, it's easy for you. But financial independence for both parties, I just don't know if there's anything more valuable than that, because I have been in a situation many years ago where I was sort of wooed into a situation where I quit my job and he was like, I don't want you to work. You don't need to work. Why are you doing that lame job? But the minute you want to do something they don't, or the minute you try to kind of assert yourself, you realize how fucking stuck you are.
This is what a lot of that dark tetra, they'll do. You know, love bombing is a term that, you know, everyone talks about. And everyone says, okay, oh, you know, I'm being showered with gifts. You know, that means that I'm being love bombed. That's not the key. The key with love bombing is first you're showered with all those gifts, but the second is the isolation.
Yes.
Once your partner begins to isolate you, financially, maybe physically. Oh, you don't need to live next to your family. Family dinner? You don't need. I'm family now. Mm. Let's go. Let's move into the middle of nowhere. Once you start to feel isolated, that's when you can be then controlled.
Yes.
That's love bombing. The showering, the isolation, and the control. And that isolation part speaks to your point where it is incredibly important for us all to be financially independent.
Yes.
All of us.
And I think TikTok and Instagram, they glamorize for young women more than ever a lifestyle where maybe the girls don't work and, you know, having a rich boyfriend and this and that. But, you know, if you follow up people's stories, the reality of that is not Birkins and Chanel shoes. It's actually not having freedom, not having the ability to pack your bags and leave if you want to.
Right.
Where are you going to go if you haven't got a car and you don't have any money in the bank account and they have your card? You're not going anywhere.
No. And then it stretches beyond the physical because then mentally you become trapped.
Yes.
Because you believe you can't make the money. Only he can make the money.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, I must stay.
Yeah.
And then you pass it on to your children. It's like, it's a never-ending
process.
And that
whole self-love thing. I think it's hard to love yourself as well when you don't have a passion. Or even, I think it does something to your... We're kind of... Human beings are programmed, I think, to serve, aren't they? And to work and to do something. And it's like, I think those periods of your life you have, and that might be staying a home mum, that might be, you know, killing it in the boardroom, but you have to have something like a purpose, don't you?
You do. That's one of the six dimensions, is having a purpose in life.
Mm.
You need to have a goal, a North Star that you feel like you are marching towards, whatever that is, whatever that is.
And it can take a minute. It took me years to find one. And I floated back and forth and I was all over the place. But just if you don't have one now, it doesn't mean you won't find it. It will come to you.
It
just can take time.
It'll take time. One of the best books I've ever read on this topic is So Good They Can't Ignore You. The author is Cal Newport. He was a professor at my university. Phenomenal book on identifying a North Star and then becoming so good, the world can't ignore you. It's a brilliant book.
Hey guys, it's Liv, and welcome to What the Foxy Moments, sponsored by Foxy Bingo. I'm going to be going through your WTF moments of this past week and trying to give you some advice. Hi, Olivia, I need your advice. My man Nathan has banned my dog from sleeping on the bed. Bruno, who's a cockapoo, sleeps oddly around my head at the top of the bed, and he has done it since he was a puppy, and I love it. Nathan's sick of Bruno because he gets Bruno's arse in his face, plus the late night trumps. He is now banned from the bed. Which man would you let sleep in the bed? Amber, London. Amber, I am a dog lover through and through. You know this. My dogs are my world. However, sleep is very important. And I feel like I can advocate a little bit for your man, Nathan, if it's affecting his sleep. But I don't want Bruno the cockapoo to be banished from the bed because that also seems unfair. So could we find a compromise where we train Bruno to sleep on the end of the bed? So then everyone can be in the bed together without arse face and without pink eye. That would be the dream. Give it a go. Let me know how you get on. Right, next one. This one's taking a spicy turn. I saw the word spicy twice. Dear Liv, a couple of weeks ago, my boyfriend tried to spice things up for Valentine's Day. He's normally very spontaneous and I kind of like it. This year was odd. First, you need to know, I recently said to him how much I was loving giant Wotsits. It was a passing comment and they were on special, so I bought two bags. He decided this Valentine's Day to share my passion for giant Wotsits and covered the bed in about 8 packets of them with rose petals. He thought this was a romantic gesture by saying, here's the two things you love, him and Wotsits. What the F was he thinking? Now I can't go near him or Wotsits, and our bedroom still smells of cheese and the orange dust has stained everything. What do I do, Nikki? Wow, a lot to unpack there. This would be my worst nightmare because the mess, the smell. I mean, it's just, at first I thought maybe the Wotsits were inside the packet, but now I'm realizing they weren't. I'm hoping that maybe he thought this was humorous. I always think the thought counts, but I think we need to communicate to your boyfriend how weird this is and unhygienic, just to make sure that nothing like this ever happens in the future. And you're going to need to get a new snack of choice. What's it's aren't very good for you anyway. So, I don't know, try an almond or something. Thanks for listening to this week's What the Foxy Moments. I'll see you next time. Talking books, I really want to... My little chicken
arm. Can you get it? Get it?
I want to slide onto this book, your book, you should kindly sent me, which I've been devouring, to be honest. And it's called Find Love, but I really do think it's not just for finding love. Like, whether you're married or you're single or anything in between, there's a lot in there about friendships yes. and, you know, just life hacks. And one chapter that I particularly really enjoyed, or it's a subchapter, is called The Power of an Introduction.
Yes.
And you have a fantastic story by one of my broadcasting icons.
Oh my gosh.
Do you want to tell it? Because you'll probably tell it way better than me.
Is this Oprah?
It's Oprah.
Oh my
and how
gosh.
Her intro to you changed the game for you.
It changed the game. Even how I was introduced to her. But yes, I think so. The power of introduction comes from, all right, I'm super nerd, so I'm going to keep dropping books.
No, do it. I love it.
All right, so Dr. Robert Cialdini. Mm-hmm. is a professor at the University of Chicago. And he's written several books, but one is called Persuasion, and another one is called Influence.
Okay.
So he is like the godfather. I keep saying the godfather. I call him the godmother. I just call him godmother. But he is like the OG of how to enter another social network. And the key with this is, so I really pulled it from him, is that whenever we are introduced mm-hmm. into another person's social network, we enter the network at the same level as the person doing the introduction.
Oh.
So let's say that you had a party tonight.
Yeah.
Right? And you were hosting the party and you brought me and then you introduced me to everybody. You're like, hey, everybody, this is Paul. And you introduced me and it's your party. I already come into their social network super high. At the top of the food chain, because it's your party. Now, if it was your party, but I came, and I just came, but I didn't come with you, right?
And I didn't really tell anyone anything about you.
Yeah, I'm just Paul. I'm not registered on anyone's social network. And this is a very important social networking concept. And in the book, I talk about how when my first television job was with freaking Oprah Winfrey.
Insane.
Insane, right? And Oprah's like, hey, everybody, this is Paul Brunson. And he's much more than a matchmaker. He's this and this and this. And all of a sudden, I became this and this and this. Like, I enter everyone who adores Oprah, everyone who holds her with high regard. Mm. I now enter their network, their minds, their thoughts at that level. And that's why the power of an introduction, it's so important that when we are being introduced, that we strategically do these things. And so, yes, the power of an introduction is huge. And Dr. Robert Cialdini goes into even more detail than me.
I think as well in the caption of this pod, we should name check some of these docs and these books just so you guys can go and find this stuff. Because I know that's what I would be doing straight away after listening to this. I'd be like, right, I'm going to read that book straight on Amazon. What would be your tips to sort of securing introductions? How do you, is it luck or are there ways that you can, and this can be for dating, this can be for work, social. So across any of those formats, how can you liken yourself to a good introduction?
Yeah, I like this. You know what? You have to ask for it.
Okay.
So you have to be specific and you have to use metrics. And this is what I mean by metrics is that, so for example, I would say, all right, so let's say I wanted to start a podcast.
Yes.
Let's just say, right, I'd say, Liv, you've got one of the hottest podcasts in the world, right? You have a phenomenal production team here. I'd like for you to introduce me to whoever it may be, the executive producer mm-hmm. who's sitting over here with this incredible jacket, right? And say, I want you to introduce me to your executive producer, and I'd like for the introduction to happen by, and this is where you have to give the metric, by a certain date. Because we always move off of numbers. We move off of deadlines. Like, that's how we are as human beings. So you give specificity in the introduction. Here's why, right? And here's the date. But you have to do that. Opposed to, you know, I want to start a podcast. You have thoughts?
That thought just goes into the air and just nothing.
Disappears. So you want to be very specific. And you'll find that those who are great at building networks and have strong, powerful social networks and professional networks are very specific on how they ask for introductions.
That's so interesting. I actually have my sister on, and she works in sales, like high up in sales. I mean, she talked about the power of a network and about, but that can change the game for you. Just the network of people you connect yourself with. But you have to be brave and you have to be direct.
You have to be brave. You have to be direct. And it always goes back to well-being.
And I think us Brits are not sometimes as good as that as you guys the other side of the pond. When it's a little bit like, oh, you know, and also I think there can be a little bit of ego gets in the way, I think, sometimes people asking for things.
Yeah, you know what I think? All right, so I've been here in the UK for 5 years.
Mm.
So I guess I think one of the biggest issues in the UK is allowing your representative to speak for you and you not speaking for yourself.
Yeah.
So I'm from New York. So in New York, we do things a bit differently. We're very brash and bold and direct. And what I saw in, because one of my 15 jobs is head of research for Tinder. And I saw something.
How do you get it all done?
Oh, man. I don't know. But in Tinder, I saw something that was really wild about the difference between the UK and the US that speaks to what you're saying.
Yeah.
So we looked at, after you match with someone, how long it takes you to go out on a date.
Mm-hmm.
All right. In the US, it's 3 days.
Right.
In the UK, it's 10 to 12 days. And you think, okay, well, why is that? And I think because in the UK, there's more of this reservation. I don't know if I should. Maybe they should. Maybe I should wait. Maybe I should play this game. And, you know, it's all of this. Whereas more so in the US, it's like, okay, are we going to meet or not?
Yeah.
Like, what's it going to be? So I think you are absolutely right. And my hope is that there's less, don't send your representative out. You go out yourself. You represent you.
Mm-hmm.
You speak about what you want. You have high standards because high standards means a higher quality of life. You set strong boundaries, but most importantly, have high well-being.
Yeah.
Yes. That's how you get. That's how you get more things.
I love that. I really, really enjoyed that. That is so interesting. And like you say, the power of it. And then you think of your own stories. You know, I remember the time that I was introduced to Brad for the first time. And I remember the way his friends spoke about him.
Mm.
And it was really strange because even though it didn't work straight away, because it took me a while to go out on a date with Brad, I remembered what he said for ages. I still remember it now. And I think it's one of the things I'll remember forever.
Interesting.
Because the way he spoke about him, he said he's super talented. He's so funny. I really feel like he's a very male version of you. And it just, everything resonated. And then I looked across the room and saw Brad and I was like, no. But then it did, what he said about him played on my mind a bit.
Yeah.
So just the power, like you say, whether it's dating, social or anything else,
it's a game changer.
Mm.
It's a game changer.
Give the boys and girls some Tinder tips, because you do hear a lot of Tinder moaning, apps in general. I can't find anyone. I'm on and off the apps. Where are people going wrong?
Yeah. So apps feel like they suck, right? It's like, oh my God. But the people are using apps more today than ever before.
Mm.
And the projection is that we're going to continue to do it because we're just not meeting people offline. Also, apps are the number one source to meeting a significant other.
Wow.
So some people are doing it right, but a lot of people are doing it wrong. So you're like, okay, what are we doing wrong? If I were to say the top two tips, it's going to sound, but I got to keep it real.
Yeah.
Fellas, can I, fellas, put a shirt on in your photo. Put a shirt on, okay? Don't man spread.
What's that?
Man spread is when they're just trying to show the package.
Big open leg situation.
It's shirt off, open leg. And I've seen shirt off, open leg, either holding cash or holding fish. Yeah, it's a big fish though.
I have a fish molesting husband and obviously
he— Oh, really?
He thinks that he's married, so he's fine. But I was sent a picture in the summer of him holding a carp. I was like, those fishy little fingers were not touching me for the foreseeable future.
Really?
What is that?
You know,
he was look at this fish. I was like, wow, so want a divorce?
Really? So he holds fish?
Yeah.
This is the thing.
I wonder if he was single, would he?
He would be.
Is it a penis extension?
It is. It is. I think the fish is like, I caught this.
Yeah, like caveman.
Yes, it's like big fish I caught. You know what I mean?
Get it out of the profile picture.
Get it out of the profile.
Illegal.
It doesn't work. It doesn't work. And then the ladies, it's like, I know you love your girlfriends.
Okay.
I know you love them.
We do.
Don't put them in your photo, ladies. Don't put them in your photo.
No, so not a group photo of the girls.
No, we don't want to see that. Because they're all like, okay.
There's too much going on.
These three I like better. Like, that's what they're saying, you know? So don't do that. No group photos. The other thing, too, is include 3 to 5 photos. There's a massive difference between someone's, quote unquote, match rate if they have 1 photo versus 3 to 5 photos. There's a massive difference if you have a full body photo. There's more match if you have full body, smiling, a photo of you doing something passionate. You get more matches. Well, you know, depending on, you know, on Tinder, you can say
not
you want
fishing.
Casual. No, not fishing. But, you know, if you have, let's say it's the podcast, it's a photo of you with the mic and, you know, you're in the studio, the things that you're passionate about, like, see, that would be ridiculous.
So show some limbs, show yourself with the top on, no fish, no group photos.
No group photos, a genuine smile.
Genuine
3 to 5 photos gets you a lot of return. Also, fill out your profile and then include what everyone's calling beige flags right now, all the things that make you unique.
Beige flags.
Beige flags. Load your profile up with all the things that you think are quirky, but you love to do.
Yeah.
You know, include that because that makes you, it shows how extraordinary you are. You're extraordinary. Mm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So include that, 3 to 5 photos, no fish, you're good. Yeah. No fish. The fish is like, why do we do this?
It's really weird. Because actually as well, like if you just grabbed a dude for a minute and you're like, do you think girls like these giant fish? I just don't know if they would even, I think they know we hate it, but they always can't control themselves. That could go down a whole, I could talk to you all day because there's a whole thing there.
It's a good one.
Girls feel safe with their friends though. That's a safety thing, isn't it? A group photo is like, you know, I think especially if you're feeling some type of way about yourself or maybe you're not feeling super secure.
Right.
It's like, this is me and my friends. It's less pressure on just you. It feels less intense.
It does, but don't do it.
No.
You know what? Have your friends.
In another photo. But not the main one.
I wouldn't even put it in any of your photos.
I would say as well, I've seen this because I do look over my friends' Tinders. If you're a guy, I don't want to see you at Ocean Beach with your friends.
No.
I actually go as far as I put that on the red flag list that we had earlier in the app. Like, that's how illegal that is.
Yeah, but I guess it though depends what you want.
Just anyone. No one should want the lads in 2 inches of water at Ocean Beach. That's what you want, you're not going to get a Brad.
I think there's some folks out there that want that, though. Come on, Liv.
Me, Come 3 on. Years ago, yeah.
See?
Look where it got me.
See?
Celebs go dating. This is my box of wrong.
Okay.
Not the one you probably saw flashed on Celebs Go Dating.
No.
Many times. And I've done them, just a couple for us, dating related, as you are here, the expert.
Okay.
So you're going to tell me if it's wrong, right, or so wrong it's right.
Ah, okay.
I've got that right this time.
Yeah.
Stalking your date on social media before you meet.
Oh, man. So wrong, it's right.
Got to do it.
I tell you what, intel. I'm all about research. I love research. You can learn so much about somebody. I think you learn a lot about someone and about how they feel about themselves on Instagram.
And you're better going in with more info than less.
Of course.
But then just don't be like, oh, how was your holiday in 2012?
Because that would be wrong. Yeah, it's so wrong. It's right. Yeah.
So do the research, but don't put all your cards on the table.
Exactly.
Nice.
Yeah.
If we do this in a heterosexual sense, boy-girl dates.
Okay.
Splitting the bill.
I mean, it's the evidence is so ridiculously clear.
Yeah.
You could have the conversation, but 99.99999% of the time, fellas, pick up.
Yeah.
Like, just do it.
I 100% agree.
Like, it shouldn't even be a topic, but it becomes this whole topic and this whole thing.
I do feel sorry for this generation. Well, I'm going to get screamed at. You're not allowed to feel sorry for men, but I do have a brother. He's younger. And I, you know, there's a lot of misinformation about, you know, women and guys and what we want and don't open the door for me and don't compliment me and all this stuff. But they say when it comes to the bill thing for me, and I'm financially independent and I would always offer, but if you accept me splitting, you're never going to see me naked. Yeah. That's the end of it.
Yeah.
You're probably never going to see me again, period.
Period, yeah, like, yeah.
I'm done
to
you.
To this is, there's a lot of misinformation.
Yes.
And this is the issue.
It's everywhere on Instagram.
It's everywhere. On TikTok, everywhere. But then if you look at the research, all the research shows that predominantly heterosexual women want the bill to be paid.
Yep.
Men think that they should, but they're confused, right?
Yeah.
And most men end up paying the bill anyway.
Yep.
You know, so it's like, okay, it shouldn't even be a thing.
And I think as well, the ick, I'm responsible for this word, which is everywhere now. And I think, I don't know, do you think people are using it wrongly?
Are you saying like you found it? You created this?
I think that I originally heard it in old Sex and the City. So I have to always give my due there, because people in this country say that I made it a thing, because I said it on Love
Really?
Island, and then people started using it.
Really?
Yes.
Are you the founder of the ick?
Well, I think...
You're the founder of the ick!
Yeah, fine. But if we're talking about icks, a scuffle over the bill and that to me would be the ick. You need a guy just to, like, say, just take it, I've got it.
Look,
that's it. Not
I'm still tripping out that I'm seated across from the founder of the ick.
So
This is big.
I took it from somewhere. I said it on Love Island.
But still,
my producer went, "What did you say?" I went, "He's given me the ick." And she was like, "Oh my God, I'm obsessed." And then since that, it's become part of like the Love Island Bible. Everyone just says it.
This is massive. This is big.
Do you hear it in your world?
All the time. I'm always commenting. Now I'm going to be like, I know who founded this. I know who did this. Yes.
Me.
All the time. On the real, I would say at least top five most popular question is always ick related. Always.
What do you think to the ick? Like, is it something, how do you understand the ick? Would you tell someone that's a valid reason for ending a dating situation, or do you push through?
I mean, you've created the ick, so I feel like you need to tell me, what does it actually mean? Because I think that a lot of people misinterpret what the ick means. Like, is it permanent, or can you, like, have the ick and then get out of the ick? Or
so,
what is it?
In my understanding of it, so when you're dating, it's very early days, the ick, like a guy going, "Oh, should we split it?" And it gets something that makes a kind of hairs in the back of your neck stand up, can actually just ruin it, can kill it.
Okay.
When you're married and you're in love, like Brad and I give each other the ick all the time. Like,
really?
If I'm in a restaurant, the other day it happened, and so I went, "Oh, excuse me," to the waitress, and she didn't hear me, and he was like, "Oh my God, this is ick." Or he was walking into Sainsbury's and he tripped up on the step, and I was like, like, ick. But I love him, so it's like, it's funny. But when you first start dating someone, I think if enough of those icks build up, it's sexual attraction.
Okay.
It just starts to dwindle, and you just can't see someone in that way anymore because you've got the ick.
Okay, so it always relates to you losing sexual attraction.
Yeah, and if you go on Instagram, girls do these crazy, they're so funny. It's like, you know, running for a bus, I don't know, like tripping over, hurting themselves, like just crazy ones, breathing.
Breathing?
Only messing. God, but you know, anyone, you can give the ick in so many stupid ways. It's like imagining a boy enjoying a roller coaster and going, ah! And then they're like, "What are they meant to do, not enjoy it?" And you're like, "I don't know, but it's an ick."
All right. I have a prediction.
Okay.
I have a big prediction about the ick.
Yeah.
I think the ick is going to meet its demise. Yes. You know why?
Why?
Because I feel like as you go younger and you get deeper, you get younger into Gen Z, there's this emergence of pure authenticity.
Yeah.
And embracing all of the awkwardness.
They're deep.
They are,
these kids are fucking deep.
Aren't they?
I mean, honestly, my brother schools me on a regular basis. Us millennials, we're quite superficial.
Yeah, and Gen X and baby, like every generation has been superficial.
Yeah.
But you know, some Tinder research is we found that Generation Z was the first generation Two, on a date, not determine if they wanted a second date based on sexual attraction. You know what it was?
What?
Do I feel comfortable being myself in front of my date?
Gee, I wasn't comfortable with the date until I was about 28.
But you know why? Because your representative was showing up and his representative was showing up. But what Gen Z is saying is no, this is me. Like, take me or leave me. This is me. And the fact that they could use that to say that's what determines if I want another date means they're on a whole nother level.
Yeah.
Like, so, and that's not every Gen Z, but that's a lot of them. Like, it's a lot of them.
God, I'm so happy for you, you smug little pricks. Yeah. What happened to good old-fashioned hating yourself and being uncomfortable?
Oh, man.
Wrong, it's right. Double texting after a date.
Oh, man.
Do you get left on red? Do you leave it alone? Or do you go back and go, hey?
Yeah. You know what? It's right.
Oh, really?
It's right. You know why? Because if you are concerned about it, speak about it. Act on it. Because if you're not, that means you're being disingenuous to yourself. You're not being real.
Go in with the double text. You've heard it here first.
Yeah. And what's the worst that's going to happen? Mm. Like, legit, what's the worst that's going to happen?
I did a 65 text. And I'll tell you, it does get worse because the police are at my door.
Yeah, at that point, yes.
Rating your one night stand's bathroom. Oh, so this is a bit of a TikTok thing where you can judge, you go in the bathroom and judge the products and the general cleanliness. I'm judging someone on the cleanness of their bathroom all day long.
Yeah. I think you could completely, I don't even think that's judgment. You know, that's actual like
information.
That's information. That's intel. Not just the bathroom, like the whole, everything about them. I think that there are a lot of people who do a great job of presenting. It's the representative presenting very well. Right. But then, you know, you say, all right, take your shoes off and let me see your toenails. And you see the toenails look like they are just going left and right and up and down. Like, you know, so I think that you could really glean into who someone is.
That's my mom always used to say to me, have your nails and your toes done and have clean knickers on.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so hit the bathroom, like the toilet, you could go to everything. I think everything about.
Well, once they got a look inside my prescription drawer, they would be running, let me tell you.
But see, that's why you're married though.
Yeah, I kept that all under wraps and so we got it signed, so. Paul, I've loved this. I could just talk for hours with you. I knew that because we've spent so much time talking previously.
Yes.
And I loved every moment of it. And this was no different.
Same. And you know, I'm very happy for you because I no longer see the representative. I see the real you, which is, this is key. And this is important. So I'm very happy for you.
Thank you.
You got it.
And guys, we're going to pop the books and everything that Paul mentioned in the bio so you can go search them up.
There you go.
This week's episode of So Wrong It's Right was brought to you by Foxy Bingo. Put some Fox in your day with new, quick, and interactive bingo experiences all at the tip of your finger. They have a huge range of free, classic, and exclusive games you can play with your mates to keep the party going. Want to connect with other players? Foxy Bingo has a community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your Fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18+, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.